A new scientific paper published in the journal Science reveals yet another major surprise from NASA's Juno mission to the gas giant Jupiter. In 2019, the Juno spacecraft twice flew past the extraordinary, long-lived anticyclone called the Great Red Spot, the longest enduring storm in the solar system. The data reveals that the storm reaches much deeper beneath Jupiter's cloud surface than space scientists can explain. A report on the findings from ScienceAlert.com states, NASA's Juno spacecraft zipped past the Great Red Spot, an anticyclone large enough to swallow Earth, twice in 2019. Measurements from those flights are now revealing the storm's structure in far more detail than telescope images can show. That data suggests that the vortex probably extends anywhere from 186 to 310 miles deep, far below Jupiter's clouds. Mysteriously, the jet streams surrounding the Great Red Spot extend even deeper, nearly 1,900 miles below Jupiter's cloud surface. The researchers aren't sure why. They do know, however, that those jets, distinct bands of gas wrapping around the planet, are keeping the Great Red Spot alive. The storm is wedged between two jet streams that move in opposite directions, powering the spin of the vortex. Juno scientist Marzi Parisi of JPL states, "It's surprising that the Great Red Spot goes so deep, but it's also surprising that it doesn't go as deep as the jets. So something is happening at 500 kilometers that is basically dampening the Great Red Spot." Unbeknownst to the scientific press, this discovery is yet another remarkable affirmation of a long string of predictions by the chief proponent of the electric universe, physicist Wal Thornhill. In July of 2017, in an interview on the Thunderbolts series, Space News from the Electric Universe, Thornhill made the following statements.
Plasma physicists have shown that Birkeland currents draw the heavy elements towards the centers of celestial bodies, and the gases form their atmospheres, with hydrogen and helium outermost. So the composition of Jupiter can't be assessed from its atmosphere. Jupiter is not mostly hydrogen and helium. All of the issues raised mean Jupiter is a solid shell composed of heavy elements. It will have structure both on its external and internal surfaces. Jupiter is not, as Scott said of the simplistic standard model, boring and uniform inside. Anywhere you look will not look the same. Finally, a word about Jupiter's Great Red Spot. Its continued presence for centuries is another argument for a solid body beneath the clouds. Its giant tornadic form is that of a continuous electrical discharge vortex from an elevated surface feature acting like a lightning rod, which could be the birth scar of one of Jupiter's moons. The Juno spacecraft is due to observe the Great Red Spot closely on its next close encounter with Jupiter, where I expect even greater gravitational and electromagnetic anomalies to be found associated with the spot.
Unfortunately, the electrical phenomena that Thornhill explained and predicted over 4 years ago are not part of the standard theoretical toolkit, and thus were not on the table for consideration by Juno investigators. However, we have repeated ad nauseum on this series that the only valid test of a hypothesis is its predictive record. By this standard, it becomes difficult to rationalize institutionalized science's continued disregard for the electric universe and plasma cosmology. It is now worthwhile to review some of the most, quote, outrageous explicit predictions by Thornhill, later confirmed by science discovery and dating back over a quarter of a century. As far back as the mid-1990s, prior to the arrival of the Galileo space probe in the Jovian system, Thornhill registered several advanced claims. Following the lead of earlier investigators Dr. Thomas Gold, Dr. Anthony Peratt, and Professor Alex Dessler, Thornhill insisted that the so-called volcanoes on Jupiter's moon Io are actually electric discharge plumes. He predicted that the so-called volcanic vents would be much hotter than lava, that the plumes are the jets of cathode arcs, and they do not explode from a volcanic vent, but move around and erode the periphery of dark areas, which planetary geologists call lava lakes. The so-called lava lakes themselves are merely the solid surface of Io etched electrically by cathode arcs. They would not reveal the expected heat of a recent lava flow. Each of these predictions received stunning confirmation. Io's volcanic hotspots were not only hotter than any lava on Earth, but were too hot to be measured by Galileo's instruments. In fact, no lava flow ever recorded has produced temperatures as hot as seen in the original Galileo image. Also as predicted by Thornhill, the discharging was found to be focused on the edges of the so-called lava lakes, though the rest of these dark fields are comparatively cold. None of the expected volcanic vents could be found. And in fact, some of the volcanic plumes were discovered to move across the surface of Io. It was also discovered that the plumes emit ultraviolet light, something inconceivable under normal conditions of volcanic venting. But ultraviolet light is, of course, characteristic of an electric arc. Perhaps most significant of all from the electrical viewpoint was the discovery of filamentary structure in the plume of the so-called volcano Vashtar. To this day, planetary scientists admit that filamentary structure simply has no place in a volcanic plume and cannot be explained. And yet, as noted previously by Gold, Peratt, and Dessler, it is the distinctive feature of the penumbra of an electric discharge. More than a decade and a half ago, Thornhill offered an equally, quote, radical prediction on the planet Saturn. On February 5, 2005, Thornhill published his analysis of scientists' discovery of a, quote, warm polar vortex at Saturn's south pole. Thornhill offered a detailed electrical interpretation of the phenomenon and chastened investigators for referring to the vortex as the, quote, first to ever be discovered in the solar system. He wrote, "Keck researchers don't seem to have done their homework, or maybe things that can't be explained get forgotten. Saturn's warm polar vortex is not, quote, the first to ever be discovered. The pioneer Venus orbiter discovered a warm giant vortex of surprisingly complex structure and behavior located in the middle atmosphere at the north pole of the planet, with a similar feature presumed to exist at the south pole also." On the question of Saturn's strange polar hotspot, Thornhill offered an explicit prediction. He stated, "The electric universe also predicts, experimentum crucis, that both poles should be hot, not one hot and the other cold." In 2008, the Reuters News Service published a science headline, "Scientists find hotspot on Saturn's chilly pole." They wrote, "Saturn's chilly north pole boasts a hotspot of compressed air, a surprising discovery that could shed light on other planets within our own solar system and beyond." Planetary scientist Nick Teenby said of the discovery, "We didn't expect it to have a hotspot at the north. Saturn's north polar hotspot was a total surprise to planetary scientists because the pole had been deprived of sunlight since its winter began more than 12 years earlier. Another clue to the incoming electric currents creating the polar hotspot is the long-lived hexagon, also at Saturn's north pole. While planetary scientists have long favored an explanation for the hexagon based on fluidic experiments, recent scientific discovery definitively excludes the fluid dynamics theory. In 2014, scientists studying data from NASA's Cassini spacecraft focused on Saturn's northern stratosphere, a region hundreds of kilometers above the atmospheric hexagon. The shocking discovery came when they began observing a vortex far above the famous hexagon. One of the investigators says of their discovery, "As the polar vortex became more and more visible, we noticed it had hexagonal edges and realized that we were seeing the pre-existing hexagon at much higher altitudes than previously thought." A 2018 Science Alert article states of the discovery, "Since wind conditions change dramatically with altitude, the fact that the hexagon shape persists so much higher than the cloud tops is a baffling conundrum." In other words, the evidence overwhelmingly favors the explanation that incoming Birkeland currents are the cause of both Saturn's polar hotspots and the mysterious hexagon structure. The Saturnian system provided even greater confirmation of electric universe theory in 2018, with the discovery of water in Saturn's atmosphere, which is remarkably similar to water in Earth's oceans. In fact, it was well over half a century ago that Emanuel Velikovsky offered the radical prediction that the source of Earth's water was Saturn, provided in an epoch when the planets were in close congregation. Thornhill's own investigation led him to conclude that Earth, Mars, and the Saturnian moon Titan were all satellites of an object he refers to as proto-Saturn. In December of 2004, Thornhill predicted that spidery ravine networks, called Lichtenberg forms in electrical terms, would be seen on Titan, not unlike the so-called arachnoids on Venus. He also stated it was unlikely that large craters would be observed, although mainstream investigators were expecting them in abundance. In the standard view of Titan, the moon is billions of years old, allowing plenty of time for massive impacts to scar the surface. In Thornhill's opinion, Titan shares a similar history to that of Venus. Both were born very recently by electrical ejection from a, quote, gas giant. In both cases, planetary scientists have proposed an ad hoc theory of massive planetary resurfacing, which has erased many of the craters. A recent birth also removes the need for a global hydrocarbon ocean to supply, over billions of years, the methane observed in Titan's atmosphere, since methane is destroyed in the atmosphere by sunlight. That too was affirmed when the Huygens probe landed on a solid surface in what looked conventionally to be a drainage basin. However, the channels leading to that basin have the distinctive appearance of surface lightning scars and need not have been carved by a flowing liquid. To date, images returned of Titan reveal that large craters are almost non-existent. What they do show are the very Lichtenberg patterns of electrical discharge Thornhill had anticipated. Perhaps no Thornhill prediction was more dramatically affirmed than the one that shocked scientists with NASA's Deep Impact mission. As far back as October of 2001, after the announcement of NASA's 2005 mission to the comet Temple 1, Thornhill wrote, "Given the erroneous standard model of comets, it is an interesting exercise to imagine what surprises are in store for astronomers, if the plan is successful. The electrical model suggests the likelihood of an electrical discharge between the comet nucleus and the copper projectile, particularly if the comet is actively flaring at the time. The projectile will approach too quickly for a slow electrical discharge to occur, so the energetic effects of the encounter should exceed that of a simple physical impact, in the same way that was seen with comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 at Jupiter." 24 hours before the impact event, in collaboration with the Thunderbolts.info group, Thornhill predicted that an electrical flash might precede the impact and explosion, and that the explosion would be much more energetic than NASA anticipated. And this is precisely what happened on July 4, 2005. Other successful Thornhill predictions included a surprising lack of increase in water production in the cometary coma, indicating a lack of subsurface water anticipated by astronomers. An unexpected lack of ice on the comet nucleus, or water in the immediate ejecta from impact. A sculpted comet surface with sharply defined craters, valleys, mesas, and ridges, the precise opposite of what one expects of a, quote, dirty snowball. A rearrangement of the comet's jets due to charge distribution. And of course, in the 16 years since the Deep Impact mission, the evidence in favor of the electric comet model has improved tremendously. The ESA's Rosetta mission to comet 67P revealed one surprise after another, including the obvious stratified rock and extreme planetary geology seen everywhere on the comet nucleus, the discovery of sand dunes and other impossible cometary features, the stunning absence of visible water ice, the discovery of molecular oxygen in defiance of the comet's origins in a primordial nebular cloud, the continued non-detection of so-called apertures which are thought to collimate comet jets, the puzzling double-lobed shape of the comet, which is also seen routinely among asteroids, and even a completely unexpected electrical aurora emitted by the comet. In fact, in the many years since the predictions we've outlined were published, Thornhill has further developed his model of electrogravity, which explains, among other things, the rounding of cometary orbits by electrical discharge. Indeed, those who have followed these presentations understand, space discovery has served as the ideal testing ground for the theoretical predictions of Thornhill's electric universe model, as well as the discipline of plasma cosmology. And of course, these predictions become more powerful when juxtaposed with the failed predictions and endless surprises for standard gravity-centric theory. This juxtaposition is both a gadfly for institutionalized science, beckoning for change, and an invitation to all inquirers, both present and future, who are inspired to discover our electric universe.